Jamie, that RRSP contribution deadline of March 1st is just around the corner. Give us a refresher on RRSPs versus TFSAs. Where do you want to put your money?
Well, again, it's different for every individual, but the rule that we've been saying for the past decade is it really comes down to your tax rate today, and your expected tax rate later on when you take the money out. So as a general rule, I would say that if your tax rate today is relatively high, but you're going to be in a lower tax bracket later on in retirement, then clearly RRSPs are the way to go. And the reason for that is you get a deduction today at your high marginal rate. And then when you're in a lower bracket in retirement, you take the money out and it comes out at a much lower rate. On the other hand, if you are in a low tax bracket now, and I would say low bracket would be anywhere maybe under $50,000 a year, if I had to sort of average across Canada, the lowest tax bracket means that probably your rate can only be higher later on in the future. In that case, I would say, you know what, earn my income, pay tax on it now at that low rate, take the after-tax amount and put that into the TFSA. Then when you take it out later on, no matter what tax rate you're on, even if you're at a higher rate, the money will come out tax-free. So again, RRSP, if your rate now is high, lower later. TFSA, if your rate is low now and could be high later on.
That was a great quick summary there. So RRSP slips coming in about now. For TFSAs, there's nothing that you should be expecting if you have made a contribution, correct?
Absolutely. So the only thing that we worry about is making sure you have all your tax slips, whether it's T4 slips for employment income, T5s for investment income, T3s for mutual funds. And ultimately, of course, if you made that RRSP contribution, you're going to get an RRSP contribution receipt. Any contributions that you've made last year and right up till March the 1st, of 2022 must be filed with the 2021 tax return, even if you choose not to claim it. But if you've made those contributions since March of last year to March 1st of this year, those are all pulled together. They're included and reported on your 2021 return. Most people will claim it. Some people may actually delay claiming a deduction for that if perhaps their income was very low in 2021, maybe higher in 2022 or a future year to get, again, that bigger benefit, right, from the deduction when you're at a higher margin rate. And this would apply maybe to someone who is a new parent who took a parental leave or maternity leave, in 2021 that maybe contributed, but has a pretty low tax bracket. And then they're back working in 2022, and then maybe they're delaying that. But again, all those contribution receipts still have to be reported on the 2021 tax return.
Let's talk about contribution limits for both, for the RRSP and for the TFSA.
Yeah, so for the TFSA, it's pretty straightforward. It's $6,000 this year, plus any cumulative room that you have. And again, you can go online to the CRA My account and determine how much that is. With RRSPs, it's basically, the easy way to think about it is 18% of your prior year's earned income. And again, earned income typically are things like employment income, self-employment income. It even includes rental income. It doesn't include pension, doesn't include investment income. I just wrote an article that just was published recently in the Financial Post about a recent tax case involving an individual who over-contributed to his RRSP because of a misunderstanding of what constituted earned income. He received a severance package from his employer. He then contributed to an RRSP 18% of that severance package. And of course, that turned out to be an over-contribution because a severance package is considered to be a retiring allowance. And under the Income Tax Act, although a retiring allowance is taxable as other income, it's not employment income. And therefore, the taxpayer lost the case and was forced to pay penalty tax on the over-contribution to the RRSP because of a misunderstanding of the definition of what constituted earned income.
Let's talk about repayment and penalties. If you have been receiving COVID-19 support benefits and you owe money, what are the options?
Yeah, again, I assume you're referring to a situation where someone has received benefits, but then perhaps they weren't entitled to it. And in case, yes, you would have to make arrangements with the CRA to repay it. There is specific rules governing the Canada Recovery Benefit And if someone made over, I think it's around $38,000 a year, then you would have to repay to the extent that your income was over that. And that will be calculated right on the tax return.
Give us an idea of the late fees, the penalties, if you owe money.
So if you owe money when you file your 2021 tax return, the payment due date this year is May the 2nd. Normally it's April 30th, but this year April 30th falls on a Saturday. Got a couple of extra days. So any amount that you owe this year must be paid by May the 2nd. As long as you file your return on time, though, there is no penalty for paying late. There would be interest. Currently, the CRA is charging interest at the prescribed rate plus 4 percentage points. So the prescribed rate now is 1%. If you add 4, that's 5%. So that's a pretty high rate, 5% interest on overdue taxes. And that interest, of course, is non-deductible. For someone in the top tax bracket, that could be equivalent to getting a pre-tax rate of return of over 10%. So you really got to think carefully. You should try to come up with the money if you can find it, and make sure that if you do owe money, you do pay by that May 2nd deadline.
Let's just go back a little bit and let's talk about some of the deductions and the credits that Canadians are eligible for. The work from home credit deduction, rather, I should say, is still an option. Do you see that continuing, Jamie?
Well, I do. The CRA has already confirmed that, of course, we had it for 2020. It's good for the return that we're filing now for 2021. And they've also confirmed it for 2022. Beyond that, we really come down to public health and what the guidance is. As you can see, I'm sitting at home. I've been sitting at home for almost 2 years now. And, you know, we're supposed to go back, theoretically, if things continue to improve with the health situation, you know, sometime in the spring. So I think as people start to return to the office, 2022, the CRA has already said no problem. You can write off the number of days you're working from home for sure. But it'll be interesting to see what happens in the fall, whether or not they would continue with this policy in 2023. And again, remember, employees could always write off a portion of their home if that was where they primarily worked. We just had a relaxation of the rules, including the simplified method of $2 a day if you were working from home as a result of COVID-19.
Budget 2022 will be tabled in the coming months. What do you hope to see? What are the expectations?
Yeah, well, there's certainly a lot of expectations in terms of, we go back to the Liberal playbook, in terms of what they had in their election campaign. There are a number of very specific things. We, for example, expect to see more details about that first-time home savings plan, where an individual will be able to save money, get a tax deduction for a first home, and then take the money out tax-free. So it's a combo between the RRSP and TFSA. They've announced a number of new credits. Credit if you renovate your home to accommodate multi-generations in your family that are going to live with you. They have a new credit for appliance repairs. They're going to expand the definition of medical expenses to include expenses of a surrogate in the case of IVF. So there's a number of things that have already been promised. We might see that come to fruition in the budget. Of course, the big question that everyone has been asking is something that was actually on the NDP's agenda. And we see even currently the NDP now voting with the Liberals on various measures right now. Could the NDP be persuade the Liberal government to do something like increase the capital gains inclusion rate? And that was actually in the NDP platform. Currently, our capital gains are only 50% taxable. The NDP want to raise that to 75% taxable. So that's the big question of whether or not the Liberals and the NDP would get together and bump up the tax rate for capital gains. That would be effective immediately on the date of announcement, most likely. So a lot of debate about that, why that's kind of a big unknown right now.